Happy Tuesday, Monday. Oh my gosh, I'm way ahead of myself. I gained an extra day just in the last few seconds. You ever do that? You forget what day it is, and then when you find out what day it is, it's really great if it's a day before what you think, because you got an extra day in your pocket. Whatever. We got Christ Jesus on our side. Why worry? Why fear? Why be dismayed? Jesus Christ loves you. He's in your life working, and it may be some other work than you're thinking or wanting, but just let his work have its way in you. We're in the book of Acts. Remember, Luke writes both Luke and Acts, and it's separated from John, but those two actually go together. Luke and Acts really are need to be seen together, especially when you get to the life of Paul, and we'll get to that down the road. I'm looking at chapter 6 of Acts. In those days, when the number of disciples was increasing, the Hellenistic Jews among them complained against the Hebraic Jews because of their widows and their being overlooked in the daily distribution of food. So the 12 gathered all the disciples together and said, "It would not be right for us to neglect the ministry of the Word of God to wait on tables." There you go. There is a clear, from the disciples, disciple himself, a clear understanding of what the disciples do. It says that we are about the ministry of the Word of God. The ministry of the Word of God. The church is the administrator of the Word of God. And it's the Word of God that is the instrument through which the Holy Spirit uses to excite faith, create faith, sustain faith, and so forth. And so they had the Word, and they proclaimed the Word. The New Testament wasn't written yet, but they knew the truths, and they preached them. Or they wrote letters, like Paul did, 13 of them, which have ended up actually finally being in Scripture. But they were to do ministry of the word. What did the ministry of the word? The church today is John the Baptist of yesterday. John the Baptist prepared the way for Christ to come into people's lives by baptizing them and by preaching the gospel. We get more, though, a little later. It says, "Brothers and sisters, choose 7 men from among you who are known to be full of the Spirit and wisdom. We will turn the responsibility over to them and give, that is, for the elderly and the distribution of the food. And we will give our attention to prayer and the ministry of the word." There's a ministry of the word again. But this time prayer is answered. That the leaders, the apostles, were supposed to be engaged with the word of God, proclaiming the word of God, making it known, giving it for consolation to the saints who are struggling, but also the ministry of prayer. Just think about that. The word of God and prayer, two priorities of the early apostles. That might be the two that we need to make as our priorities as well in the church today, is the ministry of the word. How can we get the word out there in a way that is palatable, that isn't judgmental, or isn't filled with things that are going to offend the people instead of draw the people and entice the people to Christ? We should be about the word of God. Well, we preach it on Sundays, of course. We have great Bible studies going on during the week. Those are great because we're being saturated with the word of God. The Word of God also keeps transforming us today. Not only is it an agent through the Holy Spirit that he uses in order to create faith, but he sustains faith through the Word of God. So we as leaders and as churches, our goal is to maintain faith, keep the saints growing, disciple, mentor them into a deeper life with God, make them more Christ-like. And so the leaders, but also us, the ministry of the Word. We can, first of all, minister to ourselves through engaging with the Word of God. Reading the Bible, soaking it in, listening to it, being a part of Bible studies. The Word of God needs to be central in the life of the church. It is the power of God. It is the power that God has created to work faith. They proposed 7 people, deacons, and they're going to be, you know, they're more elders. They're leaders, and they are going to help together lead the church in Jerusalem. So it says they proposed a whole group and chose Stephen. These are deacons, people who are going to take care of the needs of people. And then the apostles were the spiritual edge. They were the ones who proclaimed the gospel and prayed. Stephen, they named one of them first, full of faith in the Holy Spirit. Wouldn't you like to die with those words on your tombstone? Truly, that here's a man who was full of faith in the Holy Spirit. What else would we want on our tombstone? This proposal pleased the group. They chose Stephen, full of faith and Holy Spirit, Philip, Prochorus, Nigeron, Timon, Parmenas, Nicholas of Antioch, a convert to Judaism. They presented them to the apostles, who prayed and laid their hands on them. So the word of God spread. The number of disciples in Jerusalem increased rapidly, and a large number of priests became obedient to the faith. The faith was exploding. This was a revival. And keep praying for revival. We are still waiting to hear more from Asbury, where this kids, college kids, have been a part of what we think is a genuine revival. And we need this in our land. A revival is when the word of God, spoken or read, it accomplishes so much more than at other times. I was converted in the renewal and revival around the country back in the early 70s. And back then, it was so easy. You shared Christ with somebody, and they gave their life to Christ. It was just a strange thing. But during revivals, the Spirit is outpoured in such a way that it does its work faster, quicker, more powerfully. People are soft to the gospel, and they hear the gospel. The Welsh revival was huge centuries ago. The Great Awakening in this country, and the Great Awakening, the second one. And so the revivals are really the Word of God becoming more powerful than ever, because the Spirit of God somehow is accomplishing more through it than at other times. Pray for revival. Let's pray for renewal in our churches, revival in our land, and God, may it start with us. Heavenly Father, we praise and thank you. We glorify your name. We praise you. We worship you. We adore you. We pray that you would help us to serve you more. Those who are struggling right now today, we pray that you'd grant them strength and courage. May they not be dismayed. Give them hope in you. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's just glorify Jesus today. This sounds good, huh? Ciao.